Good morning. Thank you for inviting me to the World Wetland Day. I'm happy to note that IIT Guwahati is organizing a very important program to understand the importance of the wetland. As we all know, the wetlands provide us the water. Wetlands also help in the providing the clean water. So today my talk would be on the wetlands of Bangalore. I have titled it as the Treasure of Bangalore. The wetlands do provide the water to the society. Now, when we understand the functioning of the wetlands provide the goods like fish, fodder, and helps in washing cloth, agriculture, etc. In terms of regulating services, it helps in groundwater recharge, fire remediation, and it moderates the climate. And cultural services, mainly the recreation and information services. So now, when we look at the wetlands of Bangalore, the Bangalore topography has allowed the creation of the wetland. We do not have natural wetland, but what is done is the man-made wetland, essentially to meet the domestic and irrigation water requirement of the region. So when you look at the Bangalore of today, it's about 740 square kilometer. Way back in 1800, in this region of 740 square kilometer, we had 1,452 water bodies and 82% green cover. And because of this, the temperature in the region was 14 to 16 degrees Celsius during the May month, that is a peak summer. And for a few days in December, the temperature was 0 degrees Celsius, and we were growing apples in places like Palace Orchards in Bangalore. Today, the temperature has gone up to 34 to 37 degrees Celsius, mainly because we have decreased the number of water bodies and the green cover. That today we have 193 wetlands, as well as the green cover is less than the 8%. The city, which was the garden city, has become a garbage city in 90s, and today it has become a dead city. So when we look at the way the earlier rulers have created the water body to ensure the water security, and any city when the town is planned, they used to have the protective wall as well as the water body creation. So that's how they ensured the protection of the society, the people, as well as they ensured the water security, because the water security provides the food security. So that's how the earlier rulers have made sure the water is available to the people through the decentralized water harvesting structures or the wetlands. Now, in Bangalore, today we have 193 water bodies. All these water bodies, the quality and the physical condition we understand now because of our investigation in this region for the last one decade. Now, when we look at the groundwater, the services provided by the wetlands, if you look at the Bangalore, when the wetland was removed, the groundwater table has gone down to 600 feet after 4 years. Initially, the groundwater table was 80 to 100 feet, and then it became 600 feet after 4 years. Today, in the same location, people have gone down to 1,900 feet and there is no water, which highlights that if we want water, then we need to protect the wetlands or the lake. And to highlight one more case study, recently there are many lakes in Bangalore were rejuvenated. For example, Sarki Lake, after rejuvenation, and when the rainwater was stored in the lake, within the 3 or 4 months, we saw the increase in the groundwater table by a few feet. So that highlights that the surface water bodies or the wetlands have a decisive role in maintaining the groundwater table in the region. Then, if you want to understand the goods and services, the provisioning goods in the form of fish, fodder, etc., when the wetland is in a good shape, the people earn about ₹10,500 per day per hectare, compared to the polluted wetland where the ₹20 per day per hectare, the amount of goods the people have got. This is mainly the people who are in the immediate vicinity of the lake or a wetland are benefited, like fishermen, washerwomen, the farmers, and the other section of the people who are below poverty level or dependent on the lake. People like us who reside in the other part of the city, we are the ones who contribute to the contamination of the water bodies, etc. Now, let us try to understand how the things have started changing in Bangalore. I say it's because of the urbanization. We all know that urbanization is required, but unplanned urbanization is going to create the havoc. With unplanned urbanization, lakes have become seasonal, groundwater table has declined, as I explained earlier, and then changes in local temperature also has happened. Now, to understand this, let us look at the temperature of the region. Using thermal data, the remote sensing data, one can analyze the land use as well as the temperature of the region. What was 19 degrees in 92 became 21 degrees in 2000, of the 31 degrees in the 2006, and the same region, the same pixel, today is about 37 to 40 degrees during the May month. That shows that there is an increase in temperature by losing the natural resources like wetlands and green cover in the region. Now, to understand this further, from the center of the city, we moved in 8 directions. We see that wherever the water bodies or the open space or the parks are there, the temperature is at least 2 degrees lower. So whether it's the Hebbal Lake or Belandur Lake or the Alsur Lake, you see the temperature is at least 2 degrees lower. Even in our campus, we have the water body as well as the greenery. Because of the temperature is always 2 degrees lower, because of that, we could do a good science. In fact, we are number one in the country. That's mainly because of the good work done by the students in the campus. Now, let us try to understand in the next part the water crisis with the cities dying and wetlands, how they are decaying, which are the kidneys of landscape, how we are losing or abusing them. We'll try to understand, and some of the success stories I will share in the next part of my talk. Now, when we look at the wetland, the threats faced by the wetlands or the unplanned urbanization, because of the unplanned urbanization, we are losing the flood stream. That means the loss of the wetlands and the trees in the region. We are also not understood the importance of the flood lane, which has been abused. So then the loss of interconnectivity among the wetland is being lost, and narrowing the drains or the interconnectivity, we are narrowing it down with the concretization. So, and loss of riparian vegetation, these are all the threats that decides the fate of the wetland or the quality of the wetland. Now, to know that how the mismanagement led to the death of a city or a region, let us look from the history, the famous example of the East Island. People thought that land is available. They went on expanding the island. Then eventually the people had to abandon the island because there was no water. The similar thing happened in our country in the last leg of Vijayanagara Kingdom. The Vijayanagara Kingdom failed because of the water scarcity. That means the existence of the water body or the availability of water decides the fate of the region. Now, how to manage this? Let us try to understand. To manage the wetlands or the water body, you need to maintain the physical integrity and chemical integrity. Then only you can have the biological integrity. That means the species that occur in a particular wetland depends on its physical as well as the chemical integrity. If you pollute the water body, then the chemical integrity gets altered. With that, the species will change. Similarly, the physical integrity alteration also will alter the biological integrity. In the process, the people lose their livelihood. So now, let us see how the unplanned urbanization has taken in Bangalore. Using remote sensing data for the last 5 decades, we have analyzed. If you look at the greenery, Green Bangalore is during 1968, this one, the 68% is the greenery. The red is the buildings, the blue is the water body, yellow is the open space. And if you see, the buildings are only about 8% in 1973. And today, the 2019, you see 81% is red. That means the most part of the Bangalore has become urbanized with the paved surfaces, while only the 4% or less than 4% is the under green. So the blue also, we have lost some of them. So now let us try to animate that and visualize the thing. As I said earlier, 1973, we had 68% green cover, and aptly the Bangalore was known as the Garden City. Then 92, with the industries coming to the city, the changes started happening. Then 99, 2000, with the ITBT sector coming on the outskirts, we see the changes happening in the outskirts. Then the intensification started 2006, 2009. And when we analyzed from 1973 to 2019, we saw that there has been a 1055% increase in the concrete area, and we have lost 88% vegetation and 79% of the water body. That's where we said, enough is enough, let us decongest the Bangalore. But unfortunately, these suggestions have not been implemented yet. So now we also predicted what is likely to happen in 2020 and 2025. In 2020, 93%, that means this year, it's about 94% of the landscape would be covered with the building. And 2025, it is 98.5% would be concretized. So that is to provide the adequate water and the oxygen to the city dwellers, we need to maintain the greenery as well as the wetland in the region. So now this gives a glimpse of the wetland that we have lost. The red one are the one we have lost. 79% we have lost in the city because of the unplanned urbanization. People have not understood the importance of the wetland in providing the water. So now let us look at the trees in the city. So as per our estimate, there are seven for every 7% there is one tree, as against the requirement of 1% is the 78 trees. So now when you look at the response, using remote sensing data, we have done the quantification. This is our campus, Indian Institute of Science campus. We did the mapping using the GPS and linked that with the remote sensing data. The similar exercise, we did it for the couple of wards in Bangalore. And then we extrapolated for the entire Bangalore using the remote sensing data of a higher spatial resolution. Then we overlaid the boundaries of the wards. With that, we could find out the number of trees per park as well as number of trees per person. Our estimate shows that there has been a 14,78,000 trees in Bangalore for a population of 95 lakhs. That means for every 7%, there's a one tree. As against the requirement of the 78 trees per person. Now, you all know that when we breathe out, we give out the carbon dioxide to an extent of 540 to 980 grams per person per day. So, and 1 hectare of tree takes away about 6 to 7 or 8 tons of carbon every year. By that ratio, for every human being, there has to be the 7 or 8 trees. But what we have in Bangalore is 7 to 8% one tree. Because of that, there is a deficiency of oxygen in the city. There are instances, some of my colleagues who are staying outside the campus, they are using the oxygen cylinder to minimize the implication related to the oxygen deficiency in the region. So now let's look at the other consequences of losing the wetlands and the tree, the water scarcity and the flooding in the region. So now when you look at these are the quite common scene in Karnataka as well as in Bangalore, you see the people struggling to get the water in the region. So the floods in Bangalore is mainly because of the abuse of the wetlands. So these are the regular features, pictures which you see in the paper, which I have been noticing from 2001. And when you look at this, the consequences of the wetland mismanagement is quite evident. See, when the landscape is covered with the vegetation, the most part of the water used to go to the underlying layer, only the small part used to flow on the overland. But now with the paved surfaces, too much of paved surfaces, large amount of water in a shattered duration, which creates the flooding in the region. That is one of the major cause for the flooding in the region. Now, the encroachment of the floodplain is another cause. See, this is the region where there is a water stagnation during the normal rainfall. So that has to be protected or conserved. But unfortunately, buildings start coming and that becomes a vulnerable say, pocket for flooding. So now let us try to understand why the floodplain or the buffer zone for every wetland has to be protected. And what is the size of the buffer zone should be? See, when you want to understand the importance of the floodplain, if the floodplain is covered with the green vegetation of native vegetation, which are diverse, because of the diversity of the vegetation, you know, the soil microbes are also diverse. Because of the diverse microorganisms in the soil becomes porous or permeable, which means when it rains, it allows the water to percolate and it fills this zone, which is a saturated zone, then it fills this zone, which is a wadded zone. Then saturation of these two zones, then you see the water flowing in the river as a stream. So then you see in Bangalore and other places, we get a rain for 4 months. Then during the post-monsoon, the water that is stored in the wadded zone moves laterally towards the lake or river. That's how we have the water for the next 4 months. And during summer, the water that is stored in the saturated zone comes to the lake or river, which we call it as a base flow. That's how you have the 12-month water. 4 months because of the monsoon rain, and 4 months because of the water in the wadded zone, and 4 months because of the water in the saturated zone. So you will have enough water if you have allowed the recharge to happen in the region. But when you concretize the region, there is no scope for any the recharging. With that, you see that the lake becomes seasonal. So now this is a glimpse of a lake in the Bangalore. So now when you remove the lake, naturally, this becomes the vulnerable pocket for the flooding in the region. Then apart from that, see, we have lost the interconnectivity, and narrowing drain with concretization is another cause for the reason. See, earlier the drains were all 45 to 60 meter or 80 meter. Today, in the name of remodeling, people are reducing the width of the drain and concretizing the bed, which is against the hydrological principle. See, any drain which is natural has to allow the groundwater recharge. But by concretizing, though the contractors get the benefit of the concretization, they can make 40 to 50% of the money allocated for this kind of the work. But unfortunately, the hydrological services of the drains get affected because of this kind of foolish implementation of the project. So now, to summarize what I said so far, the lakes in Bangalore are interconnected. It used to be interconnected, and based on that, we have three watersheds. That means the water which falls in Bangalore flows in three directions. So now, when you look at the interconnectivity among the lakes, are not there. Because of that, the flooding happens. And also, if you see the every break or the discontinuity, you see the influential person sitting with the building in that reserve, or the blockage of the Raja Kalaways or the stormwater drain, you see that. That is another reason for the flooding in the region. Now, the quality of the chemical integrity of the wetlands is also threatened because of the untreated industrial effluent and untreated domestic sewage. So these are getting into the water body. Let us try to understand how this is affecting the system. So when you look at the Bangalore water body, the solid waste dumping happens. People encroach the water body and construct the apartment. And then you see that the Lakeview apartment will discharge the untreated sewage directly into the lake. Those who are away, they'll send it through the tanker. This is the Belandur Lake, which is in 90s used to be like this. Now, because of the overloading of the untreated sewage and industrial effluent, you will see that it is always covered with the green, the plants like water hyacinth, the invasive species. When the water hyacinths cover the water body, they form a thick layer. They do not allow the sunlight to penetrate. In absence of sunlight, you will see the food chain get affected. So that's what you see, that with the absence of sunlight, algae doesn't grow. Since algae is not there, zooplankton doesn't grow. Because of that, you will not get the fish. That is what our study shows, that when the lake is in a good shape, you will have the worth of the goods to the extent of rupees 10,500 per day per hectare. When the lake is polluted, the value comes down to 20 rupees per day per hectare. It's mainly because we do not get the fish. And if you look at the quality of the water body, when it is in a good condition, see, in 90s, the sewage used to enter the lake. At the inlet, the DO used to be zero, but at our outlet, it used to be the 12. But today, because of the profuse growth of macrophytes, you see the dissolved oxygen level at the outlet is less than 3 or 4. That means the lake is not doing the job of treating. The bioremediation capability of the lake is lost because we have overloaded the nutrient in the form of untreated sewage and industrial effluent into the lake. So now, these are some of the famous photographs of the Bangalore, the frothing in the lake and the industrial effluent. Frothing shows that it's mainly because of the detergent having the phosphate is the root cause for the frothing. Now, fortunately, based on our work, the government of India has brought restriction. The BIS has recently brought out a restriction on phosphate-based detergent. That means phosphate using detergent. So similarly, the occurrence of the fire along with the water shows that industrial effluent with the grease and other things getting into the water body. Of course, local people approached us and we prepared the report. This is a man, the Lokayukta. He requested us to submit the report to the government, and we did that. And now the government has taken up the rejuvenation of Belandur and Vartur Lake, and the people, the activism has worked in making the NGT to intervene and make sure that the government implement the rejuvenation. So now, see, if we allow the bureaucracy to do the remedial measures, you will see that ad hoc decisions are taken and ad hoc solutions are provided. Now, to address the frothing in the lake, which was coming to the road, what the bureaucrats of the 21st century did was they just put the barricade. So that means they thought that if they put the barricade, the froth will not come to the road. But when they did that, I wrote an article saying that this is a foolish decision. But at that time, they claimed that they succeeded. But in 4 days, the froth crossed over to say that their decision is illogical or ad hoc decision. So that is where we intervene and given the solution, so that the solutions are in the form of the Belandur and Vartur Rejuvenation Blueprint. The report is available online. Those who are interested can download and look at the report. So then if you look at the contamination in the water body, for every unit of the pollutant getting into the water body, it gets magnified in the fish to an extent of 1 million times. So we collected a fish from the water body, and also the green plant that grows in the water body as the which goes as a fodder to the cattle. That's where we collected that the green plant as well as the cattle milk. Then people grow the vegetable in the downstream. We collected the samples of the vegetables. We found that there is a heavy metal in all these items, whether it's a fish or a milk or a fodder or the green vegetable, which is also impacting the health of the citizen in the city. That's why the instances of cancer and kidney failure is going up in the city. Kidney failure, which was 1 in 1 lakh about the 10 years back, today is 1 in 5,000. Now, today the younger populations are getting affected with the kidney failure. In one of the school, I happened to meet the kid who was in LKG with her both kidneys have failed. While in the 8th standard kid, another girl child has lost one kidney. So when I look at their family background, they are even unable to meet the dialysis, which costs about 3,000 to 4,000 per week. The parents are either clerks or coolies, they are unable to meet that. That means this unhealthy environment being pushed by the bureaucracy of 21st century is affecting the people below the poverty level who are dependent on the wetland. Now let's see what are the solutions. Let us do the rainwater harvesting. Let us do the reduce, reuse, recycle of the wastewater and plant native saplings. You might ask whether these are successful. The thing, let us first understand how much water is available. Bangalore receives a rainfall of 700 to 850 millimeters, and if we harvest this rainwater, we get about 15 TMC of water. The Bangaloreans requires about 18 TMC of water for domestic purpose. That means 70% of the water required for Bangalore can be met by the rainwater harvesting. Now, to do the rainwater harvesting, there are two options. One is the rooftop harvesting. The individual houses will have 3 to 4 months additional water. While if you do the rainwater harvesting through the lake, you are also recharging the groundwater with the clean water so that the entire community gets the benefit. That's what we are suggesting the government. And the second option is to treat the wastewater. If you are using 18 TMC of water, you are also generating 18 TMC of wastewater. If we treat this similar to the what we have done at the JETCO, we are solving the problem of the water in a region. See, for any treatment, you have the primary treatment, which removes the large particles. Secondary treatment removes the chemical ions, while the tertiary treatment removes the nutrients. So the sewage has got the chemical ion as well as the nutrient. That means we need to have the tertiary treatment. But for any municipality to have a tertiary treatment, it is difficult. It is not economically viable. So because of that, the most of the places in Bangalore, people have put only the secondary treatment plant. What we have done is, what I have done is, I have integrated a constructive wetland and algal pond along with the secondary treatment plant. So this is based on the principle of wetland. As the water from the secondary treatment plant passes through this wetland and constructive wetland and get into the lake, the treatment happens. And there is a removal of 85 to 90% of the nutrient and heavy metals from the water, the treated water. Now, way back in 2005, when we have done the water quality assessment in the wells surrounding the lake, there were nitrate in the bore wells. The nitrate is a carcinogen which introduces cancer. That is mainly because the people were feeding the sewage into the lake. As the sewage moved towards from the lake to the groundwater, the N in the sewage got oxidized to nitrate. That's how the carcinogen got into the human system. Now, after the technology is implemented, for the last 10 years we have monitored the lake. Now, there are 300 plus bore wells. None of the wells have the nitrate. That means IISc has given the solution for a water at a decentralized level. The clean water is provided through the constructed wetland. And this report is available online. Those who are interested can download and read the report. And this gives the details of the amount of nutrients removed. So, now the solution for the Bangalore, as I said earlier, is if you do the rainwater harvesting, you have the 15 TMC of water. And if you treat the wastewater, we get 16 TMC. That means for the 15 plus 16, 31 TMC of water for a region where there is a requirement of 18 TMC. For this idea to materialize, I have a 5R formula. First R is a responsible citizen. When people are responsible, they will help in rejuvenating the lake so that we can retain the water. Where people are irresponsible, they remove the lake. I was told that in Assam and Guwahati, there are many lakes are being converted for the building, etc. So where sensible people are there, you will maintain the lake and we will increase the groundwater potential in the region. And also people will allow the reuse and recycle the wastewater so that they will have the sustainable situation. Now let us come to the last part of my talk, the success stories. What are the things we have done? How we have addressed the water problem in the various parts of the Karnataka and India? So rainwater harvesting, native species in the catchment. Now if you come to my campus, IISc campus, this gives a glimpse of the campus. We have a good vegetation cover. We have created a water body way back in 2008. This has become a recreation spot for our students. Not only students are benefited from this kind of ecosystem, even the animals like this are there in the region. See, at one end I say Bangalore is dying, at the other end I have the otters in the water body, and I do not go and feed these otters. Otters are voracious eaters of fish, and somehow the nature has provided the fish. So when we did the biodiversity, we saw that there's enough food for the otter. See, this gives from 2005, you can see that I am taking a measurement, 2008 onwards, every year how the lake looks like that. And this gives the algae, this is zooplankton, and this is a fish and the bird. That means the entire food chain is established in the system, and you can see the otter and also the varieties of snakes are there in the region. So recently one of my students got the skin of the snake. When we measured the length of the skin, it was found that 279 centimeters. But when we looked at the literature, what is the maximum length reported for that particular species, Naja, it was about 239 to 240 centimeters. So youngsters who are listening to my talk, you should know that I belong to IISc, the premier institute in the country. We are number one or number two mainly because of our students. Not only the student excel, even the animals in the campus also excel. That's how the length of the snake is much higher than the snakes in the other part of the country. So now whenever I meet people listen to us and they implement our ideas. This gentleman was from a region where that region has faced a water crisis for the two consecutive years, the 2014 and 15. 2016, I was traveling the region. The media had carried my travel report. This gentleman met me after hearing that I'm in his region. He spoke to me. Then after listening to my presentation, he said he has a 12 acres of land. So then my student did the study. We found out where is the lowest point, how much water can be stored. And that's where we gave a proposal for creation of the water body and also the what kind of species to be planted. Within 15 days, he implemented the wetland construction. Not only that, he also took up the desilting of some of the lakes. 2016, he implemented. And this year also, there was a water scarcity in the region. But particularly, this taluk didn't face the water crisis. Though the district had a water scarcity, this particular taluk didn't face the water crisis, mainly because of this kind of the nature-friendly solution. When I see the success of this program, it's mainly because the youth were involved in a big way. This Swamiji is also the saint, is also the young, is the age group of 35 to 40. And also the students from Alwas Engineering and Science College had taken active part. And CEO of Alwas also was responsible for this implementation in a short duration. That is where when youth, sensible youth are there, we can see the success in our plans. Then seeing the success here, so we convinced this gentleman who is the head of the institution at the Alwas Science and Engineering College. We made sure that he construct another water body in his campus which stores 25 lakh liters of water. So, and also take up the native planting. See, you all know that I created the lake in the campus which stores 10 lakh liters of water. I stay on the campus, my family uses 500 liters a day. So 500 into 365, that means my family requires about 1.5 lakh liters per year. So we are storing about 10 lakh liters. That means what you consume, you should give back to the nature 10 times that, then there won't be a scarcity of resources in our country. That's what I think, sir, you should keep in mind. Make sure that while you consume resources, you also give for the rejuvenation, replenishment or renewability of the resources. That's what we have shown. See, 2018, I visited a thing. You can see the greenery in the region with the water. That is the kind of the happiness we had when we saw this kind of the intervention. Then 2019, when I went there, I saw the water body, which was like this. So earlier, and this gentleman was alone. Today, he has a partner. I would say he got the right partner because he has created a system which has benefited the society. As a youngster, you need to understand when you do something which benefits the society, certainly your family would be happy and you will be happy and you will also excel in your academic. So and then this is another example where we have intervened and made some the bioremediation aspect we implemented and ecological engineering. See, this is a lake in the temple. This is a Koti Tirtha in a place called Gokarna. It was sinking. And when local people approached us, we went there, collected the water sample, we analyzed. We saw that the main problem was because of the ritual, people, they leave the rice balls as well as the all the puja materials, they used to leave it in the water body, which used to decay, and because of that, there was a smell and other things in the water body. So what I did is, we spoke to the priest. You can see me talking to the priest. And we make sure that these rice balls are and the puja material or ritual material are disposed at a particular location. So, and that 20 to 25 rupees was collected from each family which performed the ritual by the priest. In the process, we had a revenue of 20 to 25,000 rupees a month, which is given to the NGO. The NGO has hired three youth. Their job is to take out excess rice ball from here and give it to the cattle in the goshala. And also they used to do the DVD for two or three times a week. In the meanwhile, we also introduced a fish which eats the rice. So now for the last 3 years, the lake which was like this before I visited the place looked like this. You all know that Lord Shiva got the water to the lake, but he was taking the abhishek of this contaminated water. After he met me, he is getting the water which is a clean water. So that means one can solve the problem by the understanding the principles of the nature. See here the which also provided a job to the people, the you know Skill in India, Make in India program, the same thing is replicated here. So now let us try to see how to rejuvenate the ecosystem in other parts of the region. Say mini forest in each one, which helps in improving the groundwater table, local ecology, it improves the carbon sequestration, it helps, and reduction temperature by at least 2 degrees Celsius. Now if you come to my campus, every occasion we do the planting in the campus. So we have about 22,000 trees in the campus today. So, and if you come to my department, closer to the department, you see this climber. Looking at this architecture, this is from Western Ghats. Looking at this architecture, I felt that I should have it in Bangalore, that way in IIC campus. I got the seeds of this plant in the way back in 90s when I was a student, and out of the 14 seeds we planted, I planted 7 in 7 locations, and the 7 are still in my office. In case someone has a doubt about this initiative, they can come and do the DNA analysis to ascertain that I was responsible for planting. Now the uniqueness of this is, out of the 7 locations, in only one location it has survived, that is next to the building where I've been working for the last 2 decades. That means even the plants take knows who will take care. So otherwise you might ask, or I might ask, why it didn't survive in other 6 places which are planted by me in the same environment, same kind of soil, but it didn't survive, only in this place it has survived. So now today we get a feel of the rainforest, that is because in front of this building we created a mini forest. So mini forest of 49 species, native species, 500 saplings planted in 2 hectares way back in 90s. And at that time the region was dominated by Parthenium and the groundwater table was 150 feet. Today I have the water table at 5 to 10 feet. That means if you want to enhance the water retention capability of the catchment, you need to make sure that the catchment is covered with the native species vegetation. And because of this, temperature is another 2 degree lower, and is also habitat for various the biota like slender loris, reptiles, etc. We have this the organisms and varieties of snakes in this part of the campus. So now if you want more detail, you can go through these websites. And we also have taken up the capacity building program, and as a part of the capacity building, I'm talking to you all. Those who are interested in our activities as for a capacity building, you can may note that I have a network of about 40 institutions in Bangalore and Karnataka. We organize a symposium popularly known as Lake Symposium. I've been doing from 98, once in 2 years. So recently we conducted Lake 2020, Create New Lake and Plant Native Saplings, which I already have talked about it. So this is a glimpse of the Lake Symposium, what we had recently during 28th to 30th December. And all my talks are available online. You can download, you can read, you can understand. This is how we do the capacity building program in schools. We train the kids to do the various experiments. The kids take up the nature related experiment. They do the catchment mapping. They collect the water sample. They have been trained to they collect the sample and analyze. The kids are collecting the sample. They come to my lab. They analyze. They draw the sketches, and these are from the electron microscope. Then similarly, we are doing the capacity building for the people working in industry as well as the universities. So the details are available online. You may go through our website. These are the various archives where you can get the details. You can write to me. If you access our webpage, you will see that research paper section provides all our publications which are in PDF format. Similarly, the related to the wetland, this is the archive where the details are available. So this is the work done by us. When you look at the country landscape, 55% use. We have enough solar energy. This is the work done in 2009 because of that country solar program was formulated. Today, my students are working on biofuel from the algae. So if we harvest these three, we can make the country, developed country, with the sustainable energy. So if you have done a good job, the success is because of the youth. When youth does a good job, there is a smile on everybody's face. So thank you very much for listening, and I wish you all the success. Please make sure that you all they conserve the wetland in your hometown or in your village. So that's how the community gets the benefit. When the community has the benefit, naturally you will excel in your career as well as in your life. Thank you very much.